Tom Kramer, who is a friend of mine and is a writer, producer, and director, and who was part of Shokas Internet Radio many, many moons ago when I had that, he was co-starring with Bob Iles on Funny as Money, will speak at the beginning of The Reel You're Going to See. He said, Stu, can I just have a couple of minutes to talk about what Jack Burns meant to me as a mentor and as a connoisseur of comedy? And with that in mind, I do want to go to Steve now and talk about why, as talented as Jack Burns was, why he didn't work on as Warren on the in his role as ill-fated Warren on the Andy Griffith Show. And I think it's, I can probably give you the short answer, but I want you to elaborate. The short answer is he wasn't Don Knotts. Now,
yeah,
go ahead.
Yeah. It would have been hard for any performer to step into that role.
Yeah, tell everybody who was going to have that role until he got a starring role on another sitcom.
Well, Jerry Van Dyke had done one episode during the final black and white season, and he was really a leading contender for that. But he chose to do My Mother, the Car instead, and we can all talk about whether that was a wise decision. I'm not sure that Jerry would have worked in there either, because they almost wrote his character on the one episode that he did as so much of a milquetoast type character that I'm not sure if they had kept it in that same fashion if he would have worked. The problem with Jack Burns was not that he replaced Don Knotts. It's because the writers gave him Don Knotts material, and it didn't work. You can only give Don Knotts material to Don Knotts, as great as that guy was at crafting the Barney Fife character. But they were writing it the same way. The only thing that they injected in there was Jack's nightclub routine of going, huh, yeah, huh, yeah, huh. And when he did that, that irritated the viewers on the Andy Griffith Show. They didn't like that because it got old in a hurry. So what happened is Jack was paid off. He did, if I remember, I might have my number wrong, but I think he did 15 episodes. And then they paid him off for the rest of the season, because if you go back and watch a lot of those episodes, Andy Griffith himself looks very, very ill at ease, almost to the point that Andy is almost irritated. He wasn't the laid-back, easygoing Andy Taylor. It was really a distinctively different culture and personality that we saw with him. So, and Andy said in one of the books that was written about the show, he said it wasn't Jack Burns' fault, it was our fault, because we didn't write it correctly for him. Probably they shouldn't have gone with a deputy after that, but Jack, fortunately for him, he went on and had a very successful career behind the scenes. And I just wanted to mention this before you go to The Reel. A lot of people don't know that he was one of the driving creative talents in particularly the early years, but for several years, on Hee Haw. He was the head writer on that show. He knew how to write that kind of humor. And when Frank Pepiat and Jack Aylesworth brought particularly Gordy Tapp and Don Herron down from Canada to be part of that group in Nashville, Jack was one of the key writers on that show and occasionally would make an appearance on there. But he was underrated because most people didn't know that.
Yeah, it's ironic that he could write that humor quite well. He just couldn't act in it.
Yeah. That was the key thing. But it was, you know, because of his talent as a writer, he was able to give a tremendous creative boost to that show, and we all know the history of that, 25 years.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so let me get The Reel started, because it runs a little under, I think it's about 12 minutes long. Now, so you're going to see Jack Burns. You're going to see very short tributes to James Drury and Stuart Whitman, Jeanne Dubois, and the shows that Steve was referring to, of course, was she was the neighbor on Good Times, for those of you who don't know. I think everybody watching the show knows. And she was the co-author of the Jeffersons theme song, one of the best TV theme songs ever. We also pay tribute in this reel. I want everybody to see you make a fool of yourself, Beverly.
I couldn't resist, dude.
We're running very late, and this guy's trying to sound like a gospel singer here. Okay, so and then we're going to segue over into Lyle Waggoner. You're going to see some clips of him, and I mentioned Stuart Whitman, and we're going to end with Orson Bean because, of course, Steve has got a lot to say about Orson Bean's game show career, and everything that you see now upcoming will be pretty self-explanatory. But this is our tribute to a lot of people.
Hey, thanks, Stuart, for asking me to say a few words about my good friend, Jack Burns, because I love Jack Burns. Jack Burns is probably the most influential person that I ever had in my life. I've known him since I was a kid of 20. Back in 1979, I had submitted a short film to Bill Lee and John Moffat, who were putting together the pilot for a TV show called Fridays, and Jack saw it. He was a producer on the show, and he was very instrumental in me being brought on staff as a filmmaker and a staff writer and director later on. This was a photo that I still have. It's my favorite photo of Jack and me. That's him introducing me in one of my films on the show. Jack took me under his wing. He always referred to me as his son. And I always referred to him as my Hollywood dad. He influenced my politics and introduced me to In-N-Out Burger. And more importantly, he always believed in me and told me so even when I couldn't believe in myself. He's always there. He's always someone to talk to. He's always someone to give you confidence. And I think everybody should have a Jack Burns in their life.
I leave the room, three of you pick out an object, any object in the room, and I come back in and attempt to identify said object.
Miraculous!
Okay, but if it doesn't work, that proves that you don't have ESP, right?
All right, agree.
Okay.
Anytime you're in.
Fine.
If you will all please concentrate on the object of your choice.
Hey, this is scary, ain't it?
Floyd. The mirror.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful.
Floyd, it was the table.
Yes.
Oh, the table, huh? Well, Andy, come here. Look in the mirror, Andy. What do you see? The table, right? That's what we call reflected thought waves, Andy. From your mind into the mirror, back to the table, back to the mirror, and into my thought processes. That's unbelievable what I have, isn't it? I mean, it's absolutely unbelievable.
We call it the Burns and Schreiber Comedy Hour because I'm Jack Burns.
And I'm Avery Schreiber.
Some of you might wonder why we didn't call it the Schreiber and Burns Comedy Hour.
Yes, some of us were wondering that, Jack. My wife, my mother,
oh, no,
my
wait,
dog.
Wait. I mean, I had nothing. I had nothing to do with that.
No?
I lose my voice thinking about it. I had nothing to do with it.
Yeah.
Because, as you know, I have no ego. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
Huh?
Mean.
No. I could care less whether we call it the Burns and Schreiber Comedy Hour or the Schreiber and Burns Comedy Hour.
Really?
Really.
All right, then we'll call it the Schreiber and Burns Comedy Hour.
No, we won't. No.
Well,
the rules of comedy.
The rules of comedy?
Yeah, the rules of comedy governing comedy teams states, and I quote, all comedy teams are billed alphabetically. Uh-huh. Unless it's an alphabetical tie such as Wheeler and Woolsey and Cheech and Chong, then they're billed in ethnic order.
What are you talking? What ethnic order? What ethnic order?
Well, I'm Irish and that begins with I.
Yeah, I'm Jewish, that begins with J.
I comes before J and it's that simple. You see, it's a rule. It's a rule.
Who wrote this rule? Pat O'Brien?
No.
The I and J comedy hour? That's ludicrous.
I agree with that. It would be ludicrous, so we call it the Burns and Schreiber. We have to go alphabetically. My name is Burns, starts with B. Yours is Schreiber, starts with S. It comes out BS, so it's, you know...